what were the numbers for the other officials?
I won't say, it was like 20-something percent for Hennessy, of the 20-something, because of the three answers to the one question. Yes, currently, it's 51, I think. But we were doing, focusing on one of the issues. We kind of flipped the analysis, and we're also trying to understand, Graham Thomas is doing a bit of work right now, looking at the support for the sort of social goods, and trying to understand how we're breaking out on that issue, and we have some theories that was like, she can do that.
Hey, she did.
Well, one of the interesting things we see is that party ID and ideology just do not, they're not good indicators at all of how people feel about welfare, healthcare, or education for children. We also thought gender would be a big deal. That's turned out not to either, nor border states, nor, I mean, just all of the typical demographics aren't mattering. So we're coming up with a way of ethical evaluation and building scales, and that turns out to be the best indicator so far. So if people think in terms of empathy instead of justice, they're much more likely to agree with these policies. But overall, we still have, the majority of people are against extending it for social services. Levels of education had, it was significant at the 0.05 level, and for everything but healthcare, the higher level of education, the more conservative.
What you're treating in complicit adding to that was a goal of mine. What I mean by that is, we're going to come to say that we have laws that we have to obey and respect. I remember one time in segregation was involved. It wasn't that law. We have slavery, it wasn't that law. And we also, it was an absolute legal thing, okay, we should rid of slaves. And I think that we have a current position right now, because we say, well, we have law. It's that law, the fact that we have 50 million undocumented Americans here, and we don't treat them as Christian nation that we seem to be, or that we like to be. We have laws in place right now that make it illegal for someone to gain someone that is thirsty or hungry or needs transportation to a safe place. There is having a property confiscated, also risk being thrown in prison. So we have some very serious laws that affect Christians in America as a result of this law. And then we have something that we try to regulate the rental of property right now below Nebraska. This happened, or reenactment that we have in the Farms Watch 3 years ago, in which the city mayor and the city council and Farms Watch decided not to pass an ordinance forbidding people to rent property for workers. It ended up happening less now that the law got returned, but it cost the city over $20 million in legal fees. So I wonder where we are with that. You know, we kind of think about the laws that we're actually passing not being really.
This is where everyone is concerned, humanitarian concerns, that I'm they don't categorize this, but it makes sense if they have. Those are, and that is our, very, very careful. But they step on, takes care, here's the immigration in the Department of Land.
Deportation, like, deportation is technically, Homeland Security cannot deploy, don't be immigration terms. Those people that are out of the border, that border, are about voluntary.
Voluntary.
Because they're not counted in the deportation. If somebody refuses to voluntarily return, Homeland Security has to detain them, they can put them out of bond, they can detain them, or they can make, release them on their own, that's what they have to go before the immigration judge. Trying to bring millions and millions of people before a consultant tribunal.
Just inconceivable.
It's costly.
I have a study that estimates the cost of deportation over 50, and it's billions and billions.
So I think, if you think about the thing that doesn't make sense, is that, as I mentioned, there's different kinds of immigrants. And many people do not want to stay here permanently. It wouldn't mean deportation. People were allowed to go back and forth. I mean, I think it's as simple as that.
You see, the police folks are powerful, but this is here, all they have power. Like, even on official jobs and wages, I would say that they're probably most likely to be our union. And perhaps groups that identify, not minority, ethnic groups in the U.S. So, you know, so you've got some groups that normally align themselves together in domestic issues. On this issue, they have a chance to be in opposition to each other, potentially something. And these things are easily, probably not talked about. This has a media thing, which I think is, has certainly banned the flames.